We now go to the next lecture, and that is the SS Badrinath 2020 lecture by Dr. Lingam Gopal, sir. Dr. Lingam Gopal will be introduced by Dr. Santosh Honawat, please.
Good morning. It's a pleasure to introduce Professor Lingam Gopal, who I've come to admire and draw inspiration from. Even as a resident, he used to be the faculty at Shankaranethralaya, and we used to admire him for what he was and what he was about to achieve. He has a basic medical education from Andhra Medical College, Vishakhapatnam, and post-graduation from PGI, Chandigarh, and fellowship in BR surgery at Shankaranethralaya under the mentorship of Dr. S. Badrinath. He went on to become a fellow of the Royal College of Surgeons. He gave his best of professional years to Shankaranethralaya, and currently he's a senior consultant at National University of Singapore. That's his second life. He's as curious as a child, and you believe he got his MSc in biostatistics and epidemiology at the age of 60 from the London School of Epidemiology and Health. And he has the fastest turnover as a reviewer for IJO, which even shames the younger energetic reviewers. He has shaped the surgical skills of majority of currently practicing VR surgeons in India, and that's a very good credit. He is considered as a teacher of teachers and a true holder of Dr. S. Badrinath's legacy. His passion for ophthalmology and life are fueled by his wife, Vijaya, who is a renowned glaucoma expert in her own right. It's a pleasure to introduce Professor Gopal, and I invite him to deliver his lecture.
Thank you, Santosh.
Congratulations, Gopal. Nice to see, because right from time Gopal joined the Shankaranethralaya, I was a volunteer. Then after that, I became a fellow. And then where is Gopal?
Yes, he's there in Singapore, sir, and he's joining from Singapore.
Okay.
Gopal, sir. Welcome, sir. Welcome home.
Congratulations, Gopal. Nice to see you all the time. Looking good. I only remember the white-bearded... No.
No, I'm okay now.
So when we both became consultant, patients were easily going to Dr. Gopal because he had a white beard, and nobody came to me.
Thank you, sir.
Are you able to see my screen now?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Yes, Gopal.
I would like to at the outset thank the All India Ophthalmology Society for having given me this most prestigious award, named after my own mentor and philosopher guide. And I can't ask for anything better than this, being asked to deliver the inaugural award, which is named after my own mentor. And I would like to thank Dr. Santosh Honawat too for his kind introduction. It's indeed a great honor to be able to deliver this inaugural SS Badrinath Endowment Oration. And if I'm able to stand here today and deliver this oration, it's entirely due to this giant of a man who has been my teacher, mentor, philosopher, and guide. Dr. Badrinath can probably be described by any of these epithets and many more that have been listed in this slide. It's obvious that he assumed different roles in his life, all with perfection. But what impacted the ophthalmic community at large is the fact that he lit the lamp of knowledge in many minds. And most of us gathered here would have benefited from him, either directly or indirectly, not just about ophthalmology and VR surgery, but perhaps about everything in life. If I were to summarize his philosophy in the context of ophthalmology in one slide, it would be something that is listed in the slide. I'm not going to go into the details, but only stress on two points, which are probably very apt. That is the last two points: practice what you preach, and success is mostly due to hard work and not because of inspiration alone. The topic I was asked to speak on is science of ophthalmology and my philosophy. The last thing I would like to do is to bore you with my philosophy. Instead, I would refer you to the previous slide, the commandments of Dr. Badrinath, and these I am sure will stand you in very good stead. Well, I can stop at this, but since I've been asked to deliver this oration, I thought of sharing with you how these commandments have helped me in my life, specifically as an ophthalmologist and vitreoretinal surgeon, and a little bit of dabbling in research. They have indeed changed my life from a bumbling, mediocre man I started off with. I can confidently say that at the age of 65, I have been able to contribute to society, however small, thanks to Dr. Badrinath. Coming to the science of ophthalmology, the areas that I had the opportunity to work are these three in the main: fundus colobomas, retinopathy of prematurity, and vitreous substitutes. It goes without saying that it's always a team effort, and I was fortunate to be a part of the team which worked on these three areas. So whatever contributions I'm listing out are not necessarily my own self, but on behalf of an entire team which worked for these contributions. About fundus coloboma, we have published a few regarding the various aspects of coloboma. Just to specify a few points, a salient point which have not been stressed upon in the previous literature, that fundus coloboma, we have defined the optic disc involvement in the coloboma in a very important publication in ophthalmology. We have also described how to identify the intracalary membrane breaks and demonstrated how to identify the site of communication between the sub-intracalary membrane space and sub-retinal space, which are important in the management of coloboma-related retinal detachments. We've also described on the preferred technique of management of retinal detachments related to coloboma of the choroid in two publications set about 7 years apart, wherein we could gain more experience and found that a lot of techniques could be improved upon over a period of the last 7 years. Coming to retinopathy of prematurity, I've had interest in this disease right from the day I joined Shankaranarayana, because of the fact that I've seen a few patients of stage 5 retinopathy of prematurity for whom we have refused all treatment, saying they are blind and nothing can be done. And our initial studies have been first to identify that ROP indeed exists in India and is a major problem. Like ostriches, we have been denying the existence of ROP till that time. And once we demonstrated in publications from our center, as well as Dr. Dogra's center in PGI and one from Bangalore, that ROP indeed exists in India, it has become now an epidemic situation. Our initial experience with lasers has also been shared in publications. But what I would like to point your attention to is one particular publication which was actually spearheaded by my colleague, Dr. Parveen Sen, wherein she demonstrated that the laser to the ridge is still quite safe, because we know traditionally when the Japanese started laser for ROP, they were treating the ridge and not the avascular retina. But it's only subsequently people realize that you don't have to treat the ridge, you treat only the avascular retina. But there are a few cases which don't respond despite having had good ablation of the avascular retina. And in these cases, we found that treating the ridge has an improvement in these select cases, and it's quite safe. We also evolved a technique for the trying to reattach the retina in these detached retinas secondary to retinopathy of prematurity. We evolved a technique of stage 5 ROP, and we married the advantages of periphery to center dissection and center to periphery dissection to facilitate an entire removal of the fibrovascular tissue that is keeping the retina attached. We shifted from sacrificing the iris, which was what was recommended initially, because that gives you access to the periphery instantaneously, especially superiorly, to trying to retain the iris, but having it enlarged pupil by using the iris hooks, and thus giving us a good facility and access to the entire tissue in the periphery. The third area of interest I had was the hunt for vitreous substitutes. And here I was very fortunate that when I shifted to Singapore, I could collaborate with two important people who remain even now my important collaborators for research. One is Professor Su Zini, who is an ophthalmologist and a PhD from Cambridge. And another is Dr. Lo Shizhong, who is a polymer scientist and a professor of polymer science in A-Star Labs in Singapore. So bringing us together, and this entire team was the main contribution in addition to the laboratory science of Professor Su Zini. And to see our collaborative effort, we had two major back-to-back grants which could facilitate some amount of scientific research in this field. Our first publication was in Nature Biomaterials. It's a retinal detachment repair and vitreous like body reformation via a dermogelling polymer endo tamponade. This is a tri-block polymer, and all these three, polyethylene glycol, polypropylene glycol, and polycaprolactone, caprolactone, are approved FDA materials that could be used biologically. So none of these need approvals, but it is a tri-block polymer itself, which would of course need an approval. It is thermosensitive, it is liquid at lower temperature and becomes a gel at the body temperature. Hence it's easy to inject if it is already kept in the refrigerator because it's liquid. And once you inject, it forms a gel and has the tamponading effect on the retina. It's optically clear with a refractive index of 1.3. You can actually treat the retina through this. You can use laser, cryo, whatever you want, and has a good view of the fundus, so you can picture, photograph the retina as well as do OCT postoperatively. It's biodegradable, so it doesn't require removal. It maintains structural integrity and is tailored to ophthalmic needs in view of its transparency and optical clarity. So our initial trials in rabbit and monkey eyes have been fairly successful, which resulted in the publication. And this is the picture from the rabbit eyes, which shows the top row is non-operated eyes, middle row is operated controls, means no vitrectomy alone was done, no gel was injected, it was only saline. And the last one was where we injected our gel. And it shows that the integrity of the retina is well maintained. And the OCT shows the integrity of the ellipsoid zone and external limiting membrane, which is indirectly indicative of the photoreceptor function. We also have good results in the monkey eyes or NHP eyes, wherein we actually detach the retina first after creating a retinotomy and reattach it by fluid exchange, endolaser, and filling it with endotamponade using the gel that we have used. And we found that the macular function is well maintained both on OCT evaluation and on ERG and PERG evaluations. So all in all, the studies with the basic material that we have evolved have been fairly successful. We are now in the next stage of trying to tweak the product for commercialization, because we know that between the laboratory grade and the medical grade, there's a lot of difference. And all these have to be, including sterilization process, et cetera. And that is taking time, and that's where we are right now. We are hoping that in the next 1 year or two, we should be able to come out with a usable product that could potentially replace the usage of silicone oil. The other area where I was able to work with Professor Suzini, whose interest is in on RPE and neural cell transplant, is trying to help her in trying to implant these grown RPE cells on a scaffold into the subretinal space. So this experience in the monkey eyes and rabbit eyes could well be useful for me if one day we are able to actually grow RPE cells and implant subretinally in human beings as a routine. So these are a few of my contributions to science, courtesy the training that I have received from Dr. Badrinath. So in conclusion, I would like to state that ophthalmology is as much an inexact science as biology, as all other biological sciences, unlike physics. And hence it needs tremendous amount of observational skills and ability to sort of weigh the evidence for and against before you come to any conclusions, because it's the inexact science. And the life of Dr. Badrinath has given us several guiding principles for a very safe, effective, and quality practice of ophthalmology, as well as for developing innovative approaches. Research of any good quality needs good, sustained, and focused collaborative effort. And these are things which you learn from great people like Dr. Badrinath, Dr. Gulapalli Rao, Dr. Namparaman Swami, and others. Thank you very much for your attention. And just before we leave, I just want to share with you a few photographs of my mentor, Dr. Badrinath. Thank you very much.